Hello everyone, my name is Trevor Wu from the major of biomedical engineering. The topic that I am going to present today is the roles of osteocytes in osteoporotic fracture healing. Let's get started.
Well, have you imagined a slippery falling would cause serious outcomes? Fracture. But of course, it is rarely happened for the young people. Instead, the major group of sufferers is those who are aged. Since osteoporosis is an age-related disease that our bones have lower bone mineral density and become more fragile. So, it is readily suffering from fractures during low tremors, like falling, and this is called osteoporotic fracture. It is particularly prevalent among the old adults. In 2014, 2.5 million cases of osteoporotic fractures and $15 billion medical expenses have been reported in the United States. It is worth noticing that it occurs at metaphyseal regions instead of diaphyseal or epiphyseal regions. When compared with normal fracture healing, the healing of osteoporotic fractures was found to be impaired, with poor blood circulations and decreased number of stem cells in bones. From previous animal studies, we found that a mechanical stimulation called low magnitude high frequency vibration can promote fracture healing by around 30%. Faster mineralization and more bone formation were observed. Also, osteocytes were found to be the key to bone healing because of its mechanosensing ability. However, specific reasons for this relationship have not yet been proven. The goal of this study is to explore the roles of osteocytes in osteoporotic fracture healing. What are the factors leading to this causation? So we hypothesize that dentin matrix protein 1 is one of the biomarkers in osteocytes that is responsible for mechanosensing, mineralization, and promotion of fracture healing. In this study, over-optimized rats were used as templates, and four different groups were developed. First, obvious control and obvious vibration. Osteoporotic fractures were induced via ovaries removals. For obvious vibration, the rats were subject to vibrations. For DMP1 knockdown vibration group, it was injected with shRNA, which is DMP1 specific for gene silencing. And DMP1 scramble vibration group was injected with silane as a control group. Same as obvious vibration, both DMP1 and scramble were applied with vibrations. In dynamic histomorphology, obvious control and vibration were used 3 samples each. The sample size of DMP1 scramble and knockdown was 6 in these methodologies. All the results were compared with means using independent t-tests with significance set at p smaller than 0.05. First, for dynamic histomorphology, the rats were injected with 2 dyes at week 1 and 2 post-fractures respectively. As shown in the pictures, these are the parameters of our interest to measure. Bone formation weight and mineral apposition weight were calculated using the following formulas. X-ray scans were performed at week 2, 4, and 6 after fractures induced to monitor the fracture and healing conditions. Using imaging software, intensities at the place and fracture sites were measured to obtain normalized intensity. After X-ray, place and screws were removed to prevent artifacts during micro CT scan. Contours were used to select the fracture regions for further 3D reconstruction analysis. When it comes to H&E staining, it is a standardized method to visualize cellular structures. 2 stains were used. The first one was hematoxylin for leukei, and the other was eosin for bone tissues. IHC staining is to specifically target the proteins. In this case, DMP1 was targeted. The primary antibodies adopted were DMP1 specific, and the secondary antibodies were universal, mainly to increase the sensitivity and amplify the signals, since multiple secondary antibodies can bind to one primary antibody at the same time. Also, images at the fracture sites were taken for cell counting. Well, here comes to the result. It was found that MAR and BFR were significantly enhanced in the vibration, as shown in the graph. Also, it was noticed that in the week 6, the threshold gap was wider for DNP1 lockdown group, and the normalized intensities were higher in DNP1 scramble with statistical significance. 3D models were reconstructed and found that the threshold gap was filled in scramble, but not in lockdown. For bone volume, trabecular bone number, and thickness, DNP1 scramble was higher than the DNP1 lockdown, but the tissue volume and trabecular bone spacing of DNP1 lockdown were instead higher. In the results of H&E staining, observable fracture healing was noticed in DNP1 scramble, with more fibrous tissue breached and more woven bone formed, but less in DNP1 lockdown. Well, it is easily seen that the number of brown dots was relatively less in DNP1 knockdown, and the DNP1 signals expressions in osteocytes were found significantly lower in DNP1 knockdown. Let's discuss the results observed. Higher MAL and BFL indicated the bone matrices are formed, mineralized in the surface, and calcified. However, the red dye was dominant in signals over the green dye. Some labels would be shorter, missing, or even hidden. This could possibly be due to the dosage administrated. Plus, higher intensities in X-ray would imply more bone formation and ossification. But poor quality of X-ray films was found for week 2 and 4. It was because the X-ray was partially absorbed by the tissues that the signals were weaker. The femur was harvested at week 6, so that the radiations were less attenuated. Also, the DNP1 knockdown was found less susceptible to vibrations. Higher tissue volume and lower bone volume were observed in the knockdown group, which indicated that the bone tissues were less remodeled. On the other hand, lower trabecular bone number and thickness with higher spacing can be interpreted as less trabecular bones formations. The findings in H&E staining was not convincing enough, as no quantitative results can be obtained. For the lockdown group, the number of osteocytes with DNP1 signals was decreased due to DNP1 lockdown. Some cells were eliminated for cell counting because of their shape or color. No DNP1 signals were expressed in blue color, and dim brown color or incomplete shape would possibly be due to the 3D shape of osteocytes visualizing in 2D paint. So, it would be the start or end edges of the osteocytes. Limitations were found in this study, including small sample size and lack of results with different timelines. Since the mechanosensibility would be multifactorial, synergic effects from other biomarkers in osteocytes cannot be omitted. Also, unlike lockout approach, knockdown approach was not 100% silence of DNP1. Another limitation. To sum up, the overall results match with our hypothesis that the DNP1 is one of the biomarkers in osteocytes for mechanosensing, mineralization, and promotion of fracture healing. In vitro study and tracking of other biomarkers in osteocytes are necessary in the upcoming time. Thank you for your attention.